For some reason, I'm very nervous right now. I'm normally not this kind of nervous. It's so strange. I'm normally not this kind of nervous when I'm about to record. Maybe it's because this is a different style of video. Maybe it's because of how serious the topics are gonna get. I'm pretty sure it's because I am planning on burying a part of my soul in this video. And once you do that on the internet, that's it, it's there. And I just have to be okay with that. People are allowed to make fun of it. People are allowed to love it or hate it or think whatever they want because that's what you do when you put something out there. And that's what I'm doing. So we're gonna talk about Euphoria and why I relate to it so much. How's it going, everyone? I'm Josh with a Z and welcome back to my channel. And welcome to my channel if you are new. Today we are going to do a review and a get to know me, I guess, of Euphoria season one strictly. And depending on how this video does, I'll do a season two, perhaps. I'm also thinking about doing this in a double video format where there's a strict review version and then the combination of my personal life inputs, if that makes sense. So my general thoughts, really quick, on season one is the cinematography is outstanding. Some of the best I've ever seen. I love it. I love everything about it. The representation is very diverse and it's just always appreciated. People feel well represented. That's always appreciated too. And they were very good at subverting your expectations at points. Some things were like very obvious and some foreshadows were very in your face, but it's okay. Like, everything doesn't have to be perfect. The acting was on point. The costumes, Maddie's looks. I'm really excited to watch this style. After I watch season two, I'm gonna watch this YouTube channel's breakdown of the fashion. Oh my gosh. Maddie's looks, she is a whole vibe. She's everything. We love Maddie. Anyways, let's get into my thoughts on episode one. A few things that I feel like only someone who's experienced life like this, or at least talked to people and like got their input that experienced life like this, could create a show like Euphoria. It's just so interesting how many things were the situation was something I found myself in, or it was something happening right next to me and I watched the whole thing play out. And we're gonna start with the character that I feel like I relate to personally in the entire show the most, and that is Jewel. And you know, the start of the show is very, what do we say? Let's just say that no bars are held, okay? We're gonna say that because it's raw. It's raw, and I think it's on purpose to show you the intensity of what these teenagers are going through. This is real life for them, and that's how it would be perceived. It's also just an HBO Max show, so that's how they do things. But when I was a teenager in high school, before dating apps were what they are today, like, oh, maybe I shouldn't say the name of the apps. But you know, like, before dating apps were what they are today, there was one I used. It might even be so around, but it wasn't an app, it was a site. And it was basically the same thing. I would go on, and since I was in high school, obviously I didn't say that, and I would tell them I was older and meet up with people regularly, just like you get to know that about Jules. At the time, especially because like I have a feminine nature. Like, someone actually described me as having a feminine masculinity. I love that. That just seems so perfect. But when I was younger, it was definitely much more on the feminine side. And I used to get teased and made fun of a lot, and dating was like impossible. I only had one boyfriend. Well, I only had one boyfriend that was one of my peers when I was in high school ever. And he had a girlfriend, and no one knew we were dating except for like his brother and like people who like we knew wouldn't tell anyone. I just understood what Jules was going through by being kept a secret and having to meet up anonymously to like figure out your desires physically, your own physical desires, when everyone else is just kind of doing it at school. Well, not at school, but like, you know what I mean, with those people. But you can be a little more reluctant if you're someone like Jules or if you're someone like me. And I just understand that. And I just thought that was really raw what happened. And it was very jarring to see. I was like, oh my gosh, like the floppy wiener, floppy wiener. Wieners are, I'm desensitized, or HBO. HBO was like, we're gonna meet a quota. We're showing 50 d***s. We're gonna figure it out. And we're gonna make it cinematography. cinematographically.
A few moments later,
we're gonna make the cinematography for the scenes. Excellent. And it was just so interesting. The boy Nick reminds me of this boy I knew at, I went to a few different high schools. Jules, right? I don't know if she went to a few, but she at least transferred to one during a later part of her high school career, something I did too. So there was this boy, and he would always get so like pissed whenever I was just around. And I have a big and loud personality. I always have, you know, and I'm not shy. And I talk mad. And not like, you know, for no reason. Like, if you're gonna say something to me, I just will most likely have something to say back. Like, that's how it works in my world. Unless it's just not worth it. But anyways, but I always knew, because I always saw him around. He was a jock. And he looked like even just a shorter version of Nick. So one day we had summer school together. And I'll never forget the look on his face. It was so crazy to me how much someone could care about people even assuming that you're gay. Like, even if you're not, or if you are, but just the fact that that's on someone's mind could matter so much to a person. That was when I realized at that moment how dangerous situations like that can be. And I don't remember what he said to me, but he said something that that warranted retaliation. I said something crazy to him. Actually, I called him out. I was like, you know what? You're probably gay. And that's why you're saying all this crap to me, because you're not okay with your own sexuality. But I said it a lot more snarky and sassy. Like, everyone like got, ooh, and all this stuff. And after the like dust settled and I turned around and I looked at him, he was like going like this, like, looking at everyone, hoping that they're not talking about that. That's when I knew he was gay. And that's when I knew that he was terrified of people finding out. Nick, right? So there's a line that Rue says, and Zendeya did fabulous as Rue. Fantastic job. The cast did excellent, but she did an excellent portrayal as Rue. There's some very raw and hard to watch moments from not only her, but other members too of the cast. And I don't mean like in a cringy way, of course. I just want to make sure this is clear. I mean, because they were so good at portraying the horror of whatever it is that was happening in the scene that, you know, it was hard to watch. But Zendeya says something when she's at the party in the first episode, something that I've actually thought myself when I used to party a lot.
I remember the first time it happened to me, I got so scared. I wanted to call 911. Go to the hospital and be kept alive with machines and apple juice.
In high school, it was around my senior year. I'm not gonna say what, but I began to partake in, I don't know how I could say it, YouTube safely. So whenever I'm talking about this, I'm going to call it Euphoria because that just feels right and it's ambiguous. So when I was in high school, my senior year was the first time I took Euphoria. And I remember I was scared. Nothing scary was happening. It was such a different feeling that I got scared. And I remember thinking like, I don't want to fuck up the night, but I want to go to the hospital, but I know I'm fine. So I just understand what she was going through. The cinematography there was outstanding. I wouldn't be saying that a lot, but especially at the party scenes when they're like not quite right in their heads, the way it's shot and the way she's like spinning through the crowd, the shadows, the lights, the lighting, they play with the lighting a lot and it's wonderful. Also, Zendeya looks good in anything. They were trying so hard to make her look like a typical girl. It did not work in my opinion. I was like, you looks like a model. And then they had to put makeup on her and I was like, damn, like it's too much. You can't do anything. She looks so good. So, came in looking like Sailor Moon is a line they put in this show for me.
She came in yesterday looking all Sailor Moon and
like, there's no way they didn't know that I wouldn't love that. They put it in for me. And there were several magical girl references in this show. They talk about Madoka Magica at a point. And when later in the season is hooking up with that person, the very effeminate person. I don't know what they are, but I think it's a gay guy. So I'm going to call them the gay guy. When they were hooking up with him, he said, my name is Minako, but you can call me Venus or something along those lines. Sailor Venus, his name is Minako. Are you kidding? I was like, I am so here for this. I am 100 here for this. I loved that so much. I love the soundtrack. Labyrinth ate it up, left no crumbs, spit it out, did whatever they want. They ate that soundtrack. It was perfect. It was getting me in the mood to just do this. I was like, it took me a while to get into the show too, because I was reluctant to watch another teen drama series after 13 Reasons Why. Oh, Oh my gosh, like I was reluctant. So back to the dating apps. I think it's so interesting how the show takes the time to prove how accessible that is and how easily any teen could just like be hooking up with anyone from these apps. It's really not something that can be regulated. They can just say they're the proper age to use the app, download it, go to wherever this person lives and do their thing. I know this from experience, and that was before it was an app that you could take on your phone with you, okay? And it was easy then, so I'm just saying. I like that the show showed that because a lot of people don't believe it. This is the reality of it, okay? And like, I'm not saying all teenagers do this. I'm just saying that it is this accessible. And I think it's important for that to be showcased. Gotta give it to Rue for getting past the test in front of her mom. I've never like seen that or had to deal with that or anything like that, but that's pretty wild and clever. So for those of you who don't use Euphoria, please, please do not. I know the show glamorizes it and makes it seem fun, but your health is much more important than what that has to offer, believe me. But you're your own person. You're gonna do whatever you're gonna do. And so this is something I wanna talk about, but I have to keep it like really PG. I have to like figure out how to say this. There are different levels of taking Euphoria, okay? You can take it through different parts of your body and in different methods. I'll leave it at that. And normally, there's common ways that you start at, and then there's more hardcore ways, and then there's far gone ways. And the show does a good way of showcasing like where someone is in their addiction by how they are taking their Euphoria. I think this is important too because I knew this was Euphoria centric. When I saw Jules inject herself, I thought that was Euphoria, not her hormones. So I like, cause I didn't know, you know, until the last scene when you can basically see, I was like, oh my gosh. Like, and then there was like a hint during the first part when she is with, and then later in the episode when Nick, when he's looking through Nate's collection, that also implied that she was, you know, because she's a part of the collection, and there was what appeared to be a gay guy and a few trans women. Good foreshadowing. When the boys were sitting there and looking at Cassie's video that she was coerced into, mind you, and that she is not the only person in it, mind you, I just really didn't like that because, you know, I knew guys like this, okay? I still know guys like this, and it's just like, to me, it's gross to do that. I know girls like this, honestly, too, when they do pics, but I just really don't like the shaming factor, okay? Just because it's on video, it's something to be shameful of. Like, all she did was do it with that person. Like, that doesn't negate that that happened, whether it's on tape or not. And I don't think that should label her. Oh, like, that's just super uncool. I really didn't like that. The show doesn't show this in a positive light, at the very least. The way Rue got picked up on the highway.
Is that? Yo, that's Rue!
That was, like, nostalgia-driven. I was like, oh my gosh, like that happened to me so many times in school. Like I'd just be walking home, a group of people I knew, some people I barely knew, they'd be like, get in, let's go, we're gonna hang out and party and stuff, or just I'll take you home or whatever. The old days.
Huh? How old are you?
22.
So we're back to this scene, and I was really shocked because they showed a hard you know, and that's like, whoa. It was blurred, but like, it was hard, and you knew. Like, and it was in the front of the camera, I was like, whoa. But it was just interesting when she picked up his phone. I thought to myself, you know, I've told so many people this, they're always married. They always have girlfriends, wives, families, secret lives. So many. I just understand her. Doing Euphoria isn't sanitary to begin with, but there's something that particularly I find disgusting when people do it like with money or like in bathrooms on like, you know, like dolls and stuff or like the key. Oh my God, like it's, to me that's sick because like you touch those things with your hands constantly and you're, I don't know. You're already doing Euphoria, so it's like, who cares, but still sick. This cinematography shot reminds me of when you get the spins from doing Euphoria.
You're so hot.
I know.
The You're So Hot line could have easily been tacky. Easily! But Maddie sold it, ate it up, left no crumbs. She did that. Maddie in the pool. Like, no tea, no shade to her game. Do whatever you want with whoever you want. But at a party with everyone's phones, and they are recording at multiple angles, and you don't have any, like, way to control that,
Who are you?
I'm Jules. I'm a friend of...
A friend of who's...
So, one of my best friends is... Scene. In high school, they were super scene. He was like a scene king. And we went to this like Friday-ish party that I got invited to. And you know, people are always like, bring whoever. So I brought him as my bestie. And I remember we separated for a moment. Like I just had to get something or we just needed to separate for a moment. And he was getting hassled by the person whose party it was because they didn't know him. And then I came up and I was like, stop, he's with me. It's okay. Like it was good. That's what I mean. Like Euphoria really touched a lot of bases. And I know this isn't just like my life. So many people have lived the way and gone through those things, like me. I knew it was pretty normal, and a lot of people were going through much crazier shit. And then I was going through a lot of crazy stuff that I just didn't tell anyone. There's still things that I haven't told anyone that I have done.
I know what you are. Yeah, I see you.
You the f- are you
fucking kidding?
What the f- what the f- is your problem?
Jules is so f- hardcore for this.
By the way, I'm Jules. I just moved here.
I would have done the same thing Rue did and been like, do you want to be friends? Because that was amazing. And the can I come home with you line was just so adorable. It was really nice. Episode 2. So I knew once I saw Nick go through the collection that Jules was filmed and that he was going to see it. It was a great way to set that up though. And in my notes, Nick was popular guy for a very long time. The clips through the keyhole scene are great cinematography. Hearing Nick's story through Rue's perspective really makes me question how much of this is accurate.
Sometimes when I get really I kind of think I'm psychic.
Is this what she has observed to be absolute fact? Or is this what he actually knows as truth through Rue's words? Because this is just her story. It's an interesting thing to think about when the protagonist does and they're not mentally really there. Because a good writer will play into that. Like, is this really happening? Is she really telling the truth? Maybe this is what she does genuinely believe is the truth. But is she really there?
Made a long mental checklist of the things he liked and disliked about women. He liked thigh gaps, hated cankles. He liked good posture, fruit-scented body mist.
I know someone who used to view women with a very similar mindset. They've come a long way from that since then, but these things can happen and they need to be worked out, or you can have a crazy psychopath like Nick just around, and who wants that? I feel like it's super fascinating too when Maddie is claiming her chastity.
You're a virgin?
Yeah.
Like fully?
Yeah.
And her nails are painted red, and that is a color of seduction, meaning like, yeah, I'm chaste, but not all the way. Like, I love stuff like that. Very good symbolism through the visual. I guess that's costuming, right? One of my notes is just so many scenes, because I was just like, oh my god, there's so many. Everyone is doing it all the time. Is this the show? But it always did feel like there was purpose, and especially Jules. That had such a powerful ripple effect in this show. What she did with it basically set the show up. Oh, and someone said every guy has anger issues. Not every guy has anger issues. Okay, some girls have anger issues too. Don't gender that.
An idea. What?
This is when I see the bulge that makes me truly believe Jules is trans. I was already assuming it at this point, but this is when I was like, that's totally what she is. And dope! Like, I thought that was lovely. But what it also made me think about, because I remember being really terrified for her during that scene with just because sometimes things can go wrong. Sometimes people aren't the most altruistic, whatever. Not whatever, but it's also very much more likely with someone who is trans. And it really made me like fear for her in that situation. Even though she was out of it made me think like, wow, that was nuts. That could have been bad. Yes for the girls, okay? Yes for the girls! You better walk together. Oh, and the blackout. Here we go.
Maddie had an idea.
it had a very large ripple effect in this. I guess the ripple started with her hooking up with him, with them hooking up, I should say, in the pool. But it's still the powerful ripple effect that you feel throughout the course of the show. And not cool. Don't ever lie about that. Because I know men who would do what Nick did without proof. Like, they will just take your word for it, not ask you twice, and just go and take it further. So don't do that, please. Like, don't lie about it. Always be honest about it. Like, if you really believe that happened, like, be honest and let someone know. Do not lie about it, please. That's really, really one of the worst things someone could do. Like, yeah, just don't. But I still live for her. I love me some Maddie. Yes, we're the girls again. The butterflies on Kat's blouse are a very bold visual symbol of her metamorphosis. She's changing into something else, something that she at least considers beautiful. I'm only pointing that out because they play with that aspect in the show. Like, is this really empowering or is this like degrading? I also felt like the symbolism there was specifically towards her losing her chastity.
Tell us a 5-minute story about your summer. Looks like we have our first volunteer, Rue.
Please don't do this to me.
When Rue was forced to go on stage, she's shaking, she's got out of rehab and stuff, and the teacher like forced her to do that, I was like fuming. I was like, I hate this teacher, I hate this teacher. My note here is I literally hate this teacher for torturing her like that, completely unnecessary and taken too far. I was fuming. Why do that? She's clearly physically in anguish from having to do this. It's so not that important. Don't make her do it. Also, just a really quick note, the makeup artists for this show are phenomenal at however they need the age to be differentiated. They do a fantastic job. I just want to give that to them. I'm sure part of that is the editors too and the CG, you know, playing with colors and stuff. Everyone who plays the role in that did fantastic.
We need you to backdate this slip.
Ethically, that's a line I will not cross.
What if I suck your
like in my car?
I'm 17, you f***ing creep, sign the slip.
I think it's so clever how the younger cast members in the show use PC culture to their advantage. Absolutely love it. Absolutely love it.
Then let's hear it for the East Highland Black Hole!
I love the mascot and the colors of the school. I would have loved to go to this school. They look so, so good. The Madoka reference.
What about later?
Probably gonna do some homework, binge watch some Madoka Magica.
And I was just so here for it. Jules wanted to watch it. Super cute. I'm so here for that.
Daddy, I just want to say that I'm sorry.
Maddie is a f***ing vibe.
Just stay right there, keep your mouth shut, and be cool. These dudes ain't f***ing around.
No, I'm not gonna lie. That's when I started to get a little scared.
This is when I found Rue to be incredibly unlikable. And of course, that's done on purpose because she's a drug addict and they're usually not very likable. But it was very annoying. I was like, can you listen to anyone around you? Like, can you just not indulge in your own vices? But she's a drug addict. So how well does that show the portrayal that Zendeya did as the character of Rue and the writing and everything working well together? Because that was supposed to annoy me and it did. Mouse.
Well, hello there, little sis. My name is Mouse. It's a pleasure to meet you.
I have been around so many men like this, dealers and, you know, people who distribute Euphoria and, you know, running gangs and stuff. This one time, there was this person who I was really close to. Her ex was someone who would sell Euphoria and was a gang member. And he came to our house and I was in like these loose, like fitted pajama pants and like a, I don't know, just a tank top, but I was kind of like scantily clad. It's the point I'm trying to make. And I didn't know this, but like he was in a deuce too. And he, what did he say? Someone said something about like, they were making fun of how feminine my pants look. And everyone laughed at whatever comment. I remember who made the comment, but I'm not gonna say who it was. Someone made the comment, everyone laughed. And then he was the only one who said, it looks cute though. And I was like, oh, that was where I was like, signal, signal. Then later on the balcony, we're all talking, it was me, him, and the person, he was his ex. And he was like, I forgot what he said, but it led to him caressing my face and saying, but you're so beautiful. And I was like, wow, like it really threw me off. But it was so fascinating to me because he was so scary that no one would say anything about it. They just wouldn't. He was terrifying, like terrifying and handsome. So when he forced Rue to take Euphoria, a much stronger, potent, effective kind of euphoria. It reminded me of how when you're in a situation where people are doing that, and if they're unsure of you, they expect you to partake, to know that you're cool. And the grossest part of it, ugh. So she licks his knife. Oh my god, it's so sick, it's so sick, it's so sick. She's a euphoria dealer, so can you imagine any gangsters? Like, can you imagine what that knife has been through? Oh, she licked it. Does he clean it probably ever? No? I don't know, oh my god, sick, sick. And at the end of this episode, I noted Shy Guy is for sure the popular guy, because he's still a popular guy in my notes at this point. It's not like the show was trying to make that a big secret, because they reveal it very fast, but I thought that was well played. All right, feeling nice and refreshed. Took a quick break. Episode 3.
They demand the release of their queen.
It's like a darker version of the jungle scene from Mean Girls. And one thing I really loved about this episode was the way they showcase texting, the showing the parallels of where they are and the way they had the split screen. One of my favorite shots was when Jules was on the roof and he was in the locker room. She's laying down, but because of the way the screen is, she's like parallel with him. I thought these were really nice shots. I love watching them get the perfect photo. A lot of best friends have done this. I've done this. We've done this with the besties. We gotta look good. And who else would help us better than our best friend? And this whole episode, the soundtrack has been fire. Absolutely outstanding. Love, Labyrinth.
I don't want to fight with you.
I don't want to fight with you either.
You have to understand that I just want you to be safe, okay? I don't want anything bad to happen to you.
This made me cry. I know, like, we ended up finding out that was just Nick she was texting and that he had very up motives for doing that, but it was just nice seeing her be so giddy and excited about being potentially with someone, and it was just a cute thing until it wasn't.
You're my soulmate.
Thank you.
My first note is, why is everyone so mean to Cassie? What did she do to deserve everyone's negativity being thrown at her? And then my next note is, Maddie's carnival look, best look of the season. Ate it up, slayed it, killed it. Stomped it to the ground. Oh my gosh, she looks so f-ing good.
Yeah, I'm not supposed to be here right now because I'm dressed like a hooker and none of you like me.
Yeah, she did look like a hooker. A high class hooker. Now the way they set up selling euphoria in the carnival, so cool. Obviously selling euphoria is not a cool thing, but that was brilliant. You have to get a specific ticket to purchase their pretzels.
We don't eat carbs.
Two, please.
That'll be 40.
That come with their euphoria, you know? Like, that was very well crafted and very cool to see cinematically play out. The girls are like,
thank you.
It is cute. At this point too in the season, I'm beginning to assume, and I still think this as of right now, and I finished season one, that Nick is trying to emulate what his dad does by having a beard. If you don't know what that is, you can go ahead and Google it, but it's a term. But by having Maddie be his beard, and I don't mean it offensively, I think it's appropriate, by having Maddie be his beard and then a secret lifestyle too. And I thought this because he kissed Jules. He didn't have to do that. Like, he wanted to do that. So, you know, no one was around. She definitely didn't want to. I'm just saying, like, there's hints leading up towards it, especially since he's been watching his dad's videos, I think, like, since he was a kid. What that could do to your brain. Anyways. This is when I was getting really into the show. Everything at the carnival was just happening. It was heart-wrenching. I was on the edge of my seat. I was laying down for most of the show. And then we got to that episode of the carnival scene. I sat up. I was like, oh my gosh, who's gonna run into who next? What is happening? Like, it was just wild. From the freaking, the big O on the carousel to, you know, the girls getting euphoria from the cleverly placed setup to freaking Jules going up to... That was so stupid on her part. She's playing a dangerous game by doing that. That's a dangerous game because people get like crazy about that stuff when they're like, I gotta hide it. I'm not saying it's okay. I'm just saying it's a dangerous game. Right after that, I mean, like, Maddie is a f-ing vibe the whole season, but like, she was a f-ing vibe at this carnival. What did she say?
But I just wanted to say congratulations.
Maddie, get out of here.
Knocks over the chili. She's a vibe. Okay, I'm here for Maddie.
No.
I know that you have these ideas about me.
Can you let go of me?
So this is when Jules goes to meet Shy Guy and she finds out it's Nick. And there's just something about the way the cinematography was, knowing how she felt about him, the fact that he kissed her.
I kind of feel closer to you than I do to anyone in the whole world.
I don't trust you, Nate.
They're by a lake, it's nighttime, like no one really knows where she is except for Rue. The words I could use to describe the feeling that I felt the whole time was alluringly frightening. Somewhere where you know you're not supposed to go, but you just really, really want to. You feel like there's something there that's worth the trouble. And that was just what this whole like scene was giving me. But, and I was scared knowing, you know, she's trans. I was like, is he gonna like kill her? There's a lake right there. Like, I don't know. It was just nuts. And especially cause like she got catfish, like it's not Nick, like they don't know that it's him if they ever got the files. It was just a wild situation and something really scary. And what I really gathered from this whole situation was there is really something to be learned about sending pictures of yourself like that out to people and how to truly authenticate them. Like obviously the best way is to put your face in it, but that's also a true authentication, which could lead to a leak and people everywhere seeing. And it's just, it's an interesting game, the game of social media. This is one thing I loved about the show too. They incorporate the stress, the delight, the addiction, everything that comes with social media very well with the characters and the whole world. It doesn't feel forced or like you're doing it to get to the kids. It feels like what it is. Like this is how it functions in the world. This is how synonymous it is with life, at least in these this part of the world. You know, why not showcase it like that? And they did a brilliant job. Episode 5. Immediately. Maddie is giving Regina George 2.0.
That one.
Got your present.
Really?
She's giving Gen Z Regina George. She's giving. I'm here for her. I love Maddie. I know she's awful. I know. But I love Cersei Lannister too for being awful. She's awful. I don't want to be like them. I don't idolize them, but I love her character. She's just like, I'm gonna do what I want. I'm gonna get what I want. I'm gonna do whatever it takes. And it's really fun to watch. At 44:35, we get the Minako reference to Venus.
I'm from planet Venus, baby. I'm Minako, but the boys call me Mina.
Sailor Venus, come on! That was amazing! And I thought character was such a fascinating way, especially at this point in the show, to showcase the closeted nature of men with his kind of lifestyle. I have been with these men like this romantically. I have been with them for only physical desire. They have a very specific kind of wiring, and it's normally no one can ever know. Anyone who needs to hear this, please be safe. I'm not saying like don't meet people and have fun, but please be safe. Always, like whenever I did go to meet someone anonymously, I texted a friend that I knew, like this is their plates, this is their house, this is what something. Just so if something ever did happen, at least there's a leak that they could, you know, get to me or something, you know, just let someone know, do something.
Do you think this stuff affects them even if they don't know it?
I thought his pondering on whether him hiding that part of himself in that lifestyle was having an effect on his kids. And I remember when I was watching it and I thought, no, it's not. How could it? They don't even know. That's why it is. Of course it is. You're hiding a part of yourself that you truly love to indulge in. They're gonna sense it if they don't straight up see it. And I thought it was very interesting. I think only Maddie says it, but she was like, your whole family is weird as f-. Episode 6. So we come back to the issue, like, you know, the issue of her, the tapes of her being out there. Of course it is. Throughout the whole series up until this point, we just haven't mentioned it yet. And like I said at the beginning, this just really frustrates me because that should not put any like shame on you or make you feel any type of way because you made that. The only real... Oh, also too, this is another thing for episode 5 because I forgot to mention this. Even the Minako, Mina, Venus had a chain.
Yeah.
There's no way that wasn't Sailor Moon. They were even blonde. One of the men said that you had less self-respect. Someone said that you have less self-respect for doing that. That is the opposite, okay? You have more self-respect because you're confident in your appearance. And a lot of the things I remember, because we get to find out more about this in the next episode, she didn't want to do that a lot of the time. They not only coerced her, but they did it without her permission. She was like covering up and saying no. They're still recording her. I'm just saying, like, it's not so black and white, and like shaming people for footage of that is never cool. You do not know the story. All you know is that that exists. This whole episode, I was living for all of the Halloween looks. Zendeya, stunning. Jules, like an angel. And I love the parallel, like a very opposite, like to the T, even a dark base versus a light base. Like everything was opposite with their looks, and it very much symbolized a drift, which came to a head at the end of the season. The Bob's look was freaking amazing. I know Halloween does persuade people to do the sexy thing, but if you're gonna do something super clever, go with that too.
I'm Alabama Worley from True Romance.
I feel like if we go to this party and you dress like that, I ain't gonna ever hear the end of it.
I'm just gonna say, support your partner in how they wanna look. If they want to look with style and flair, sexy, whatever, support them in that. It's only a compliment to you. Be supportive. Jules at the party, it's really crazy thinking like she can't tell anyone what she did. She did something straight up incriminating, and then it's still being blackmailed, you know. What do you do except for drink your sorrows away? Don't do that, but I'm just saying that's what she's doing. Nick gets in trouble for, you know, grabbing freaking Maddie by the neck so hard she is bruised, and they say he's temporarily expelled. And I'm like, what is that? What literally is being temporarily expelled? Expelled means forever. So my question is like, why wouldn't you just say suspended? Maybe there is a reason they said temporarily for like legality or something. I don't know. But that bothered me a lot. And then experiencing this episode, Maddie and Nick fighting so hard to stay together, even though they fight with each other, they're not very good for each other, reminded me so much of my toxic ex. Like, we did the exact same thing for a while until I was over that shit. But this is something that happens a lot, especially when you're young. And a lot of it's just because physically it feels really good to be with them and you just want to keep doing that. So this guy, I forgot his name, but the one, I'll put it on the screen, but the one that's romantically interested in Kat, I just felt so bad for him so much. Like the whole time, ever since the carnival, I felt really, really bad for this dude. I was like, she didn't even have the nerve to ask him, like, were you flirting with that girl? What was happening with that girl? So she didn't even ask, she just assumed and then went on a rampage. That was one of her more unlikable moments in the show, honestly. And this episode really showcase how controlling McKay is. He has been that way for the whole show. And especially at the end, like, he's very unlikable to me. Probably one of my least favorite characters. Not that he's poorly done. He's actually done very well. I just don't like the decisions he's made. And especially once we get to 2618, when we got here, it was just like, so, it was probably the most uncomfortable moment for me to watch in the show. And I know that's gonna seem odd considering what's already happened, but this was just really, really uncomfortable to watch just because they were both not into it at all. And it seemed like he only felt the need to prove his manhood because, and I'm pretty sure they didn't actually do anything to him, right? That was just like, they were dry humping him as a frat joke, right? Not saying it's cool because that's really scary and f***ed up, having a team of dudes come in and pin you down to the ground and dry hump you. It's not fun. Just after that, I just wish he would have been okay with not doing anything. Like, she even said he was crying and all this stuff. You don't have to keep having just because you were, and then something happened and finished. Like, it was really deeply uncomfortable to watch. Oh, and then later in the episode, we come back to the party, and then we see Chippendale's dude. Best costume. That's the best costume. Bob Saget's really good, too. Have I been saying Bob Saget this whole time? I've been saying Bob Saget this whole time. I meant Bob Hope. Is it Bob Hope? Bob Ross! Damn it! Bob Ross! I've been saying the wrong one! I meant Bob Ross. I'm sorry I haven't been saying it right this whole time. Bob Ross. The Bob Ross costume in Chippendales are the best. And also the writing up until this point has been fantastic. The pacing has been excellently crafted. Character motivations are placed well and leading into other events and having it organically open up the world more and closing other situations. It has been doing an astounding job. I'm very impressed. So We know that Maddie was attacked by Nick and that she's in crazy love with him. She's super into him no matter what, even through the physical aggression. Don't be like that. And we know that he went and beat the hell out of the boy who hooked up with Maddie in the pool, right? And that he was blackmailing him too. He's really about blackmailing people. When he went to him and made him confess for the crime he committed against his own girlfriend, I was disgusted. I was grossed out. I was appalled. And so impressed. That was some gangsta sh**. It was very impressive. It really solidified the lengths he'll go to preserve whatever it is he's trying to keep preserved, you know? And it made us, when he calls the raid in on Fez, that much more significant. Because, like, of course he would. He did all that shit. Of course he would call a raid in on you. Like, when they entered that Halloween party in their costumes and the music's playing and everyone looks at them and they're chanting, it sucks because they're both terrible and they shouldn't be together and they got away with something they should not have. And yet it feels so triumphant. Like, you want them to do it. Like, I found myself at so many points rooting for them to get back together. And that is so weird for me because I hate the relationship. I don't know. It's weird. It's weird. I don't even want to talk about it anymore. Episode 7. This one I had the least amount of notes to put because I just really didn't feel like it was my place to talk about a lot of the subjects that they touched on in it. But it was a fantastic episode, and let's get into the notes I did take. It's overall about and her experience. She gets pregnant and she is teetering back and forth. But it's really more about her coming to terms with it being a thing and then telling McKay about it. Her ice skating was so gorgeous. Loved it in the beginning. Giving Yuri on ice, you know what I'm saying? And Zendeya, as Detective Zendeya, I live for it, I'm here for it. She's so funny, except for when she was at Fez's house and she wouldn't stay in the room. And like, I really get they're trying to portray how significant her addiction is because she can't even be in a room around it. Like she did, and that happened earlier in the show at Jules' house. She did happen to stumble across some euphoria and took it, even though she was trying not to. So she really can't be around it. I understand that. It frustrated me to almost no end that she would not stay in the damn room. She never listens to Fez. He's such a good guy. He seems like he's a gangster, but like he's a sweet guy. They paint him out as someone you want to root for. And this episode just made me realize like Fez is the realest one. I mean, he is really the realest one after he stopped selling to Rue. I thought that was really cool too, but he's the realest one and I love him for this.
All I'm saying is leave her and her friends alone.
It's a threat.
Nah, I'm just telling you.
Season finale. So this one focused a lot on the winter formal. That's what's happening at this point. And I think for the first time since we saw the girls cross paths in the first episode, because there is a scene where they just happen to like cross paths for a second. But ever since then, I don't think we've seen them all together, including Rue and Jules with these girls ever. But it was really informative to see them all sitting together and talking about their aspirations for after school and how they're feeling about life at the moment. It was so interesting seeing Jules and Cassie compare notes per se, because Jules is like, she's like, I feel suffocated, I just don't I'm ready to leave school. And Cassie feels like it's the best time of her life, she's not gonna get any better than that, which is so sad. If there's anyone who's watching who needs to hear this, high school is not it. No one peaks in high school. I guess some people may, but like there's so much more life ahead of you. You're gonna do fine. You have time to figure it out. Don't put pressure on yourself. So later in the episode we have another scene between Maddie and Nick, and he can't. So, you know, she starts questioning things, and, you know, because she found, we didn't talk about this earlier, but she finds D-pics in his phone, but it's the pics he was sending to Jules to catfish her. It wasn't actually his. She didn't know that. So all she sees is. Even though she wasn't very sensitive about it, I thought it was nice of her to be like, it's okay, like, I don't care, like, I still love you, I'll still be with you. Because that showed a lot about her character, because she's very snarky. The whole show, she is snarky. Even to him, but she was like, you know, it's okay. She was trying to comfort him because she knew this was, like, a lot for him to deal with. And like I said earlier, when she left the house after that, she talked to Nate's dad, she said,
your whole family is so f- weird.
Yes, hon! Take that video, because she's gonna watch the video. I'm so excited to see what comes of that. She's gonna watch the video, find out that that's Jules, and It's just, it's the whole thing. Like, things that happen organically very well. The only thing I didn't like was, like, he's keeping it in a book on his desk. I don't like that. That just seemed like, why? That's very important. Like, your dad could just walk in there and then see that, and then he'll know you took it. I don't know. It just didn't seem very smart. Kind of lazy to get Maddie to get to it, but that was one of the few low points of the show, and there's barely any.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Why don't you kiss me?
This is when we really find out with absolute certainty that Jules is not being satisfied 100% physically by Rue. And I don't mean just physically, because like, it's a part of it is romantic because she wants to be really like kissed by her. It was very telling how in a relationship someone can be being physically satisfied but not romantically, and vice versa. But I feel like she meant like in a passionate way. Like, why don't you do a physical kiss in a passionate way? And during the dance, I noticed the lighting playing a lot with shifts between blue and pink, and obviously these are transitioning colors. And I just thought that this was the show symbolizing a major change about to occur. And I just thought that was very nice visuals to give. I thought this was so cute when he said,
you know, I mean, like, is one of us gonna get hurt? But I'll do my best to make sure that it's me.
That was so cute. That was so, so cute. I love that so much. That whole situation reminded me of when I asked my first boyfriend to be my boyfriend. We were walking to the store. We were next to the street on the corner, and we were holding hands, and I asked him to be my boyfriend, and he said yes, and then we started kissing, and then a car was driving by, and they were like, woo! And it was so cute, and I just thought it was really sweet, because, like, you never know what can happen. Like, go the opposite way. So, Jules and Rue, well, Rue really brings up, what if they just, you know, left the dance and went home and packed a bag and then went into the city and tried to figure out life from there? Jules couldn't agree more and think that was a better idea. She's like, yes, like, what a brilliant thing. Like, almost as if she was already planning to do that and that she was happy Rue would just be coming with her. You know, that's how it ends. And it's really, it's crazy because, like, I actually got kind of mad at Jules. So I was like, why don't you just not go yet? Just don't go yet. Maybe stay the night and think about it, go the next day. Like, Rue clearly needed you. And she made a mistake when she said that. She didn't really mean it. So I got a little upset with her. But Jules is also entitled to do whatever she likes. Like, it's her life. And if she wants to do that and go into the city, she's perfectly within her right to. And it ends with a dance number, a very beautiful dance number. It's very artistic. And the last thing we see is Rue doing Euphoria. And that's the end of season one. This is a fantastic show. I barely touched on anything. Like, I talked a lot about it, but there's so much I did not cover. Like, plot setups and Jules' dad and Rue's mom might be a potential couple. I didn't say anything about that. There's a lot of things I did not say. But I love this show a lot. I'm definitely going to watch season two. And let's see if this video hits, I don't know, 50 likes, then I will do another expose like this on season two and add, you know, my little personal experiences that relate according to whatever happens in season two and onward. And yeah, and isn't it kind of wild to think that I'm pretty sure this happened over the course of a few months, maybe half a year, because like they went from the beginning of the school year to winter formal, and that's like promised the end of the year. Winter, at least for my school, it was homecoming, winter formal, then prom. And prom was like way after winter formal. So there seems to be like a lot of room for them to cover if they would like to keep them in this setting for a while. And it's a lot of fun. The soundtrack is outstanding. All the acting is superb. No one was a weak note, in my opinion. And all the characters have something to do and great motivations. I didn't even touch on Rue's little sister story. There's so much to say about this show. It's packed with content. I still suggest, even if you haven't seen it and you just watched me talk about it, to go watch it on your own if you like. It's very good. There's still a bunch of stuff I did not cover. But I hope you enjoyed this. If you enjoyed yourself while I did this expose on my Euphoria story and basically did a review on Euphoria, please hit the like button. If you made it to this part of the video and you're feeling ever so inclined, subscribe to join the Z fam. We can always use another member of the family. And please comment down below what your thoughts on Euphoria and my review. Do you want more reviews like this? It's a lot easier for me to watch a whole series and then do this than episode episode by episode reaction. So let me know if you want me to do anything for you. A great place to reach out to me to tell me to do those things is my social media links that will be on the screen and in the description box down below. So that's a great place to reach out to me and hang out. It's just fun over there. I try to post daily. Also, I would like to say thank you to my wonderful patrons. I love you so much. And we have Patreon goals now. So at 10 patrons, I will be doing the season one of Avatar The Last Airbender's looks, thanks to this person's comment, Hillary Major. Thank you for the suggestion. I love it so much. We will be doing the season one Avatar looks in a deep dive. Like, we're gonna talk about their cultural references and stuff like that. All of the season one looks, or not season one, I'm sorry. All of book one season one's looks at 10 patrons. At 25 patrons, I will begin doing Owl House reactions as a Patreon exclusive. And at 50 patrons, I will begin releasing them weekly on the main YouTube channel. At 75 patrons, I will do a deep dive on the fashion of Avatar The Last Airbender, the whole series. Not Korra, but just that. And at 100, I will do a deep dive on every single Marvel movie ever made up until the point reached at 100. I don't even care if something comes out the next day. I will not do it. It does not count. But up until that point, I will do it. I mean, deep dive. We're talking fashion, acting, cinematography, CG, overall writing, story lengths, pacing. We will talk about it all. At 100, those are the goals. Thank you for supporting. The link is down below if you would like to support me there. And just thank you so much for watching. This was a lot of fun to do. I had so much fun watching this show and breaking it down, bringing my own personal experiences into it. And I hope that maybe you learned something. And you're a wonderful community. I love you, and you deserve to be here and be safe and loved and happy, okay? I'll see you for the next one. Bye.